Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahilladzi hadana li hadza wa ma kunna linahtadiya laula an hadanallah. Allahumma shalli wa sallim ala sayyidina Muhammadin al-fatihi lima ughliq wal khatimi lima sabaq nasirul haq bil haq wal hadi ila siratikal mustaqim sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam haqqa qadrihi wa miqdarihi al-azim. Amma ba'd. Subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal alimul hakim. Rabbi syrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Amin ya rabbal alamin. Awalan نقدم جزيل الشكر لمن أقام هذا المجلس فنسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجمعنا وإياهم في جنة الفردوس مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين أمين يا رب العالمين وثانيا نقدم كذلك جزيل الشكر لفضيلة الأستاذ لقمان على ما بذله من أن يترجم محاضرة هذه المحاضرة فنسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينفعنا بكم الجميع أمين يا رب العالمين. Bisa diterjemahkan dulu. Nah, saya minta terima kasih atas kesempatan untuk saya diberi kesempatan untuk ceramah di sini, dan yang kedua terima kasih kepada antum yang sudi menerjemahkan.
Assalamu alaikum. Habib Jamal would like to thank everyone for coming inside this majlis, inshallah. He praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, he hopes that we will all, we can all take benefit from this majlis. And inshallah, I will be here translating for him, inshallah. So.
Tema kita hari ini adalah bagaimana kita menambah kecintaan kepada baginda Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Our topic or theme today is how we can increase our love for our Maulana Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Cinta kepada Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah asas yang penting untuk kita cinta kepada Allah Subhanahu wa taala.
Love of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the basis for our love for Allah Subhanahu wa taala.
Dengannya Allah Subhanahu wa taala berfirman dalam Al-Qur'an, "Qul in kuntum tuhibbunallaha fattabi'uni yuhibbukumullah." Katakan wahai Muhammad kepada umatmu, apabila kalian cinta kepada Allah, maka ikutilah aku, ikutilah Nabi Muhammad, niscaya kau akan dicintai oleh Allah.
It is with this basis that Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that if you claim to love Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow me so that Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala may love you in return.
Ittiba' yang disebut oleh Allah, ikutilah aku, ittiba' thamaratul mahabbah. Mengikuti adalah buah dari cinta. Seorang mengikuti seseorang karena kecintaan, maka itu mengikuti dan cinta kepada Nabi akan menghasilkan dan membuahkan kecintaan dari Allah Subhanahu wa taala.
The word of ittiba' used in this ayah, fattabi'uni ya'ni, is a following out of love. So we follow Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam out of love, and it is a following, the fruits of which is love of Allah Subhanahu wa taala.
Dengannya ulama berkata, kalau engkau ingin mengetahui sebagaimana cinta Allah kepadamu, maka lihatlah bagaimana kau mengikuti dan mencintai Nabi Muhammad.
Likewise, the ulama say, if you want to know how much Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you, then take stock of yourself and see how much you love Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Maka dari itu, kita harus menumbuhkan di dalam hati kita dan anak-anak kita kecintaan kepada Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam agar kita dan keluarga kita dicintai oleh Allah Subhanahu wa taala.
That is why we must nurture in our hearts and the hearts of our families, our children, love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam so that Allah Subhanahu wa taala can love us and our families as well.
Dengannya agar kita cinta kepada beliau baginda Muhammad, maka kunci satu-satunya adalah ma'rifah, yaitu mengenal beliau.
And one of the keys to loving Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is ma'rifah, or knowing Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Tidak akan pernah orang mencintai Nabi Muhammad tanpa mengenal siapa beliau Nabi Muhammad.
One cannot, will not love Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam without knowing who he is first.
Para sahabat dan para tabi'in di dalam sirah disebutkan mereka mengenalkan kepada anaknya bagaimana Nabi Muhammad SAW mengajarkannya seperti mereka mengajarkan surat Fatihah kepada anak-anaknya.
The companions and the tabi'in, those who came after the companions, would teach their children about how
mengenalkan kepada anak-anaknya siapa Rasulullah, akhlaknya Nabi, kemuliaan Nabi, seperti mengajarkan surat Al-Fatihah.
The companions and the tabi'in would teach the way that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to conduct himself, his akhlaq, his noble character, the way they would teach surat Al-Fatihah to their children.
Karena itulah mereka, anak-anaknya, tumbuh dengan rasa cinta kepada Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Because it was such a fundamental part of the teachings that they passed on to their children, the love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was nurtured and it grew within their children.
Hingga mimpi berjumpa dengan Nabi untuk para tabi'in dan tabi'at tabi'in adalah hal yang sangat luar, sangat biasa.
Such that this teaching was so widespread, it was so common that for the tabi'in and the tabi'at tabi'in, the generation after them, for them to see Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to meet him in their dream, is commonplace.
Hingga ada di antara mereka yang menangis tersedu-sedu apabila dalam waktu 40 hari tidak berjumpa dengan Nabi dalam mimpinya.
It was so common for this occurrence that they would cry so much if 40 days passed and they did not see Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in their dreams.
Kita sekarang 40 tahun kadang-kadang belum pernah mimpi sekalipun kepada Nabi Muhammad.
For us, maybe 40 years have passed and we have not seen Prophet Muhammad SAW in our dreams.
Ini karena jauhnya kita, tidak mengenalnya kita dengan Nabi Muhammad SAW.
This is because of how far we are, because of how little we know about Prophet Muhammad SAW.
Padahal kalau kita mempelajari, mengkaji, membahas tentang sejarah beliau, kita pasti cinta kepada beliau baginda Muhammad.
We are so far, even though if we studied his history, his sirah, we would definitely fall in love with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Seorang yang tidak beriman kepada Allah ketika mempelajari orang-orang yang mulia di muka bumi ini hingga akhirnya menulis satu buku dan mengatakan orang yang terhebat di dunia ada 100 orang hebat, ditulis yang pertama adalah Nabi Muhammad. Karena apa? Mempelajari sejarah Nabi dan mengatakan terhebat adalah Nabi Muhammad.
Michael Hart is a non-Muslim. He does not believe in Islam, but he studied the most noble men to ever walk this earth, and he could only conclude that the most noble man, the greatest man to ever walk this earth, is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Kalau orang kafir bisa mengetahui kemuliaan Nabi Muhammad karena mempelajarinya, maka bagaimana dengan kita yang beriman dengan Nabi Muhammad?
If a non-believer, someone who does not believe in Allah, in Islam, if he can acknowledge how great Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, then how about us who actually believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
Dan kadang-kadang yang memalukan untuk kita sebagai orang tua, kadang anak-anak kita lebih kenal dengan superstar, kenal dengan pemain bola, dan tidak kenal nabinya Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Sometimes what is even more embarrassing for us is that our children, they know celebrities, they know soccer players, but they know very little about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Padahal Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam beliau bersabda, "Ahibbullah lima yaghdukum bihi min ni'amih wa ahibbuni lihubbillah wa ahibbu ahla baiti lihubbi." Cintailah Allah Subhanahu wa taala yang karena telah memberikan kenikmatan kepada kalian. Dan cintailah aku karena cintamu kepada Allah, dan cintai keluargaku karena kecintaanmu kepadaku.
All this, and yet Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, love Allah for the ni'mah that he has given you, and love me because you love Allah, and love my family because you love me.
Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam pun bersabda, la yu'minu ahadukum hatta akuna ahabba ilaihi min walidihi wa waladihi wa fi riwayah wan nasi ajma'in. Tidak sempurna keimanan seorang di antara kalian hingga bisa mencintai aku lebih dari kecintaan kepada orang tuanya dan anaknya dan semua manusia.
And in another hadith, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, one has not believed until he loves me, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, more than he loves his own parents, his own children, and in another riwayah, more than all of humanity.
Maka itu kita harus bagaimana mencintai baginda Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, dan tidak ada caranya kecuali mempelajari dan mengenal, membaca sejarah beliau Nabi Muhammad.
So we must find a way to love Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there is no other way other than to study, to analyze and to read, at least read his history.
Kemuliaan Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam dengan yang apa yang diberikan oleh Allah ada dua hal.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given two things that made him above others.
Disebut oleh Sahibul Burdah dalam kitab Burdahnya, "Wansub ila dhatihi ma syi'ta min syarafin, wansub ila qadrihi ma syi'ta min 'idami." Pujilah Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam apa yang ingin kau puji dari dua hal. Yang pertama kedudukannya di sisi Allah, dan yang kedua adalah zatnya Nabi Muhammad.
The Sahib al-Burda, in the Burda, there is a bait in which we are asked to praise Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one of two things. The first one is his status beside Allah subhanahu wa taala, or him of himself.
Maka untuk kita mencintai Nabi Muhammad, dua hal. Yang pertama, kedudukannya di sisi Allah, dan yang kedua, zatnya Nabi Muhammad, kepribadian Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
And so for us to praise Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or to acknowledge his greatness, we should look into his status besides Allah, or him of himself, yani his conduct, his akhlaq.
Yang pertama, qadruhu indallah, kedudukannya beliau di sisi Allah subhanahu wa taala, bahwa sesungguhnya beliau adalah imam para nabi dan imam para rasul.
His status before Allah, the first of the two, is that he is the imam, the leader of all the prophets and the messengers.
Suatu saat ketika para sahabat duduk, mereka saling memuji para nabi, satu dengan yang lain memuji nabi. Ada yang mengatakan Adam, masya Allah, adalah satu-satunya nabi yang langsung diciptakan oleh Allah. Kemudian satunya mengatakan bahwa enggak, Ibrahim ittakhadallahu khalilan, Allah jadikan dia sebagai teman dekat Allah. Satu mengatakan la, Musa kalimullah, satu lagi mengatakan la, Musa ruhullah. Satu dengan yang lain, mereka saling memuji keutamaan para nabi.
In a gathering in which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was present with his companions, the companions were praising various prophets. One talked about Adam alayhi salam, how he was directly created by Allah. He was a prophet who was created directly by Allah. Another was praising Ibrahim alayhi salam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him as a khalil, as a close friend. Others were praising Musa because he spoke with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly, and others still were praising Musa because he is ruhullah.
Ketika Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam mendengar dialog para sahabat tersebut, maka Rasul SAW menemui mereka dan berkata, betul, Nabi Adam mulia karena langsung Allah yang menciptakannya. Betul, Allah memilih Nabi Ibrahim sebagai khalilnya. Betul, Allah menjadikan Musa sebagai kalimullah. Allah menjadikan Isa sebagai ruhullah. Tapi ingatlah, wa ana habibullahi wala fakhar, dan aku adalah kekasihnya Allah dan aku tidak sombong. Dan kelak nanti ketika di yaumil kiamah, aku akan memegang bendera puji-pujian kepada Allah, Adam wa man dunahu tahta liwa'i yauma idzin. Dan semua nabi yang kau sebutkan nanti kelak ada di belakang benderaku kelak di hari tersebut.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon hearing this, he responded, "It is true that Adam was created directly. He was a prophet created directly. It is," and he continues, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "that Ibrahim alaihi salam was taken as the Khalilullah, and Prophet Musa was Kalimullah, and Isa is alaihi salam Ruhullah. But remember that I am." Yani Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not showing off when he says this. In fact, on the day of judgment, he will be given a standard with of praise, and all of the prophets will be behind him.
Yang kedua, keutamaan yang Allah berikan kepada Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, dan beliau adalah sebagai paling afdolnya Nabi, hingga kita pun menjadi paling afdolnya umat. Dengan Nabi Muhammad lah, kita umat Nabi Muhammad adalah 2/3 penghuni surga. 2/3 penghuni surga adalah umat Nabi Muhammad, yang 1/3 adalah dibagi untuk seluruh para Nabi dan Rasul.
Prophet Muhammad SAW, the second reason for his greatness is that he is
paling mulianya Nabi.
He is the greatest, most noble of the prophets, and therefore by effect we are the most noble of the ummat, and we will occupy 2/3 of Jannah due to being the ummah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whereas the other 1/3 shall be divided amongst the other prophets.
2/3 penghuni. Itulah kemuliaan yang Allah berikan kepada kita berkat Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
And that is the nobility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted to us through Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Kedudukan beliau Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mengungguli semua kedudukan para nabi dan rasul.
The status of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam surpasses the status of all other anbiya.
Itulah qadrun nabi indallah, dan itulah kedudukan Nabi Muhammad di sisi Allah.
That is qadrun nabi indallah, that is the status of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam before Allah.
Sekarang kemuliaan yang kedua untuk zatnya Nabi Muhammad, maka dibagi menjadi dua, khuluqan wa khalqa. Nabi Muhammad zatnya mulia karena dua hal. Pertama, akhlaknya, dan kedua adalah parasnya beliau.
The second source of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's nobility, why he is the greatest of all, is him of himself. His that, which can be separated into two categories, his khalq, his physical form, and his khuluq, which is his character.
Akhlak, beliau langsung dipuji oleh Allah yang menciptakannya, bahwa beliau Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah sang pemilik akhlak yang paling mulia.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly that he is the most noble in character.
Wa innaka la'ala khuluqin 'adzim. Kemudian akhlak Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ditulis dalam kitab sirah, dan kita lihat bahwa Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam menjadi barometer untuk semua akhlak yang mulia. Dikatakan akhlak itu mulia karena itu ada pada baginda Muhammad.
If we study the sirah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we will find that it is written there that the noble character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the milestone, the measurement, the barometer through which all noble character is measured. Something is called noble because it is found in the character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Seperti orang yang pemurah, yaitu orang yang dermawan. Dermawan itu mulia. Nabi Muhammad itu mulia bukan karena dermawan, tapi kedermawanan itulah mulia karena itu sifat Nabi Muhammad.
For example, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was like to give. He was very generous. It is not that generous is noble by itself, but generosity is made noble because it is one of the character. It is found in the character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Karena itu dalam Al Quran disebutkan wa innaka la'ala khuluqin adhim, ala harful lil isti'la, di atas akhlak yang mulia.
And that is why in the Quran, Allah swt describes the noble character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with harful isti'la, ala khuluqin adhim.
Dari itu Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mempunyai semua sifat kemuliaan karena beliaulah sumber daripada segala akhlak yang mulia.
That is why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you study his character, you will all find all traits of nobility because he is the source of noble character.
Saya beri contoh bagaimana kasih sayang Nabi Muhammad kepada umatnya atau rahmahnya Nabi Muhammad kepada umatnya. Suatu saat Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam beliau berdiri di pasar melihat ada seseorang pembantu atau budak yang ketakutan, seakan-akan diperintahkan oleh tuannya, akan tetapi dia mempunyai masalah. Maka didatangi oleh baginda Muhammad dan ditanya, "Ada apa denganmu?" Maka dia berkata, "Aku diperintahkan oleh tuanku untuk beli makanan di pasar, tapi uangku jatuh dan hilang."
Habib Jamal would like to give an example of the nobility of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's character, specifically how much he cared and loved his ummah. In one narration, in one incident, there was a servant in the market who had a look of fear. The servant was very afraid for the master, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached the servant and asked, "What is the matter?" And the servant replied, "I was supposed to buy something, but my money fell and I can't find it."
Kemudian budak tersebut ketakutan karena dia tidak bisa membeli dan uangnya hilang. Kemudian Rasul berkata, "Berapa uang tuanmu tadi memberi?" Dia sebutkan uangnya adalah 4 dinar. Dan di saat itu di saku Nabi Muhammad ada uang pas 4 dinar. Maka diberikan semua uang tersebut agar Nabi Muhammad meyakinkan atau agar orang tersebut tidak dimarahi oleh tuannya.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after asking, and the servant replied that the servant had lost the money that the master had given to purchase something from the market. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, "How much money did you lose?" And the servant replied, 4 dinar. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had 4 dinar exact at that time. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam persuaded, gave the 4 dinar to the servant so that the servant would not have to face the wrath of the master.
Semua 4 dinar yang ada pada Nabi diberikan kepada orang tersebut.
All 4 dinar were given to that servant.
Kemudian senyum budak tersebut, kelihatannya alhamdulillah selesai dari permasalahannya. Maka Nabi pun ikut bahagia dengan kebahagiaan budak itu.
And the smile that came on the face of that servant, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam became happy because the servant was happy as well.
Berangkat budak itu ke pasar, beli semua apa yang harus dia beli. Kemudian ketika mau pulang, terlihat lagi tampak dia ketakutan lagi.
So the servant took the 4 dinar, went around the market and bought all that was asked. But after that, the servant still had a look of fear on his face.
Didatangi lagi oleh Rasulullah, apalagi sudahkah uang itu kau dapati yang 4 dinar, apalagi dia berkata bahwa sekarang aku takut ketika aku pulang karena aku terlambat, yang semestinya waktu untuk membeli ini semuanya tidak selama ini, tapi aku khawatir tuanku itu marah karena aku mengambil waktu yang begitu lama dalam hal ini.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked again, what is the matter? Like, why do you have everything? You got everything you came for. What is it that still troubles you?" And the servant explained, "I'm afraid that if I return to my master, I wasn't supposed to take this long to purchase all of these things. I'm afraid that he will scold me because I was late."
Kemudian kata Nabi Muhammad SAW, "Kalau begitu, aku akan antarkan kamu ke tuanmu dan aku akan sampaikan apa yang menyebabkan keterlambatan ini hingga engkau tidak akan dimarahi oleh tuanmu."
So Prophet Muhammad SAW, in consolation again, told the servant, then I will accompany you to your master and I will explain to your master what it was exactly that made you late.
Sampai seperti itu, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam cintanya kepada umatnya hingga budak itu pun dia akan bela mati-matian agar dia tidak dimarahi oleh tuannya.
That is the love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for his ummah, such that he would even defend the rights, care for this servant, such that he would not have to face the wrath of his master.
Diantar sampai ke rumah tuan tersebut. Kebetulan rumahnya adalah di luar kota Madinah sedikit. Kemudian ketika Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam mengantar tuan rumah itu, nampak Rasulullah seakan-akan menuju rumahnya. Melihat hal tersebut, dia terheran-heran. Ini adalah kemuliaan yang besar dari Allah ketika Rasulullah ingin datang ke rumahnya. Dia lebih yakin ketika di sebelahnya adalah budaknya. Maka orang tersebut dan anak-anaknya masuk ke dalam rumahnya dan ditutup rumahnya.
So, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam accompanies the servant to the master's house, which turned out to be quite a distance from Medina itself. And the master of the servant is looking from afar and he sees such an honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving him, that he is being visited by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. And he was made even more sure because it was his servant. You know, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not just happening to pass by, he is going to his house. And in order to greet this honor, he makes a special preparation. He tells all of his children to go inside the house and he shuts all the doors.
Ketika Rasulullah sampai di rumah tersebut, Rasulullah memberi salam kepada mereka, assalamualaikum, tapi tidak ada satupun yang menjawab di rumah tersebut.
So when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam reaches the master's house, he gives salam, assalamualaikum, but no one in the house replies.
Maka Rasulullah mengulangi lagi, assalamualaikum.
So Prophet Muhammad gives salam again.
Kemudian hingga yang ketiga, assalamualaikum. Maka yang punya rumah dan anak-anaknya serentak mereka menjawab, waalaikumsalam ya Rasulullah.
And on the third time that Prophet Muhammad gave salam, assalamualaikum, then the master of the house and all of his children responded, waalaikumsalam warahmatullah.
Dibukakan untuknya pintu.
And so he opened the door for them.
Dipersilahkan Rasulullah untuk masuk.
He beckoned Prophet Muhammad, please come enter.
Bahagia tuan rumah dan anak-anaknya.
And the master of the house and his children were so overcome with joy.
Maka Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam pun ikut bahagia dengan kebahagiaan tuan rumah tersebut.
And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was also happy because they were happy.
Kemudian tuan rumah tadi karena bahagianya menawarkan kepada Rasulullah, ya Rasulullah, kedatanganmu kepadaku ini lebaran.
So the master of the house told Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, your presence here is like a celebration.
Kemudian beliau berkata, apa yang kau inginkan ya Rasulullah, aku akan lakukan. Kau minta sembelihkan unta, aku sembelihkan. Kambing, aku sembelihkan. Makanan apa, apapun yang kau inginkan.
So the master of the house asked Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tell me what it is you want. Would you like me to, if you want, I shall prepare a meal, I shall slaughter a camel for you. Just tell me anything and I will give it to you.
Tapi Nabi yang keinginannya hanyalah untuk menyelamatkan umatnya. Keinginannya bukan untuk perut dan kekayaannya. Mengatakan, aku tidak ingin apa-apa. Kepadamu cuma aku ingin satu. Jangan kau marahi budakmu yang pulang terlambat ini karena dia tadi terkena musibah.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as the messenger of Allah who cares so much for his ummah, he did not come to fill his belly or to fill his coffers. He came, he asked, I only want one thing from you. Please do not scold this servant of yours. He is late because a calamity befell him.
Lihat bagaimana cintanya Nabi Muhammad kepada umatnya. Ini budak yang diselamatkan, bukan seorang anak raja, bukan seorang anak khalifah, bukan juga anak orang kaya. Seorang budak yang diperjualbelikan, tapi Nabi Muhammad begitu ingin menyelamatkannya dari masalahnya.
So look at the person that Prophet Muhammad wants to save. It is not the son of a king. It is not the son of the caliph. It is not the son of a wealthy person. It is just a servant who is part of the ummah, part of his ummah. And yet, look at how hard he is trying to make sure that this one servant is saved.
Maka bagaimana Nabi Muhammad kelak akan menyelamatkan umatnya dari api neraka Allah Subhanahu wa taala?
So how then, how hard do you think Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will, how much effort he will give to save his ummah from the fire of Jahannam?
Kemudian tuan rumah jadi bahagia kedatangan Nabi Muhammad dan Nabi meminta untuk jangan dimarahi, maka karena bahagianya budak itu mengatakan, ya Rasulullah, min ajlika fahuwa hurrun min ajlillah, karena permintaanmu aku tidak marah, maka karenamu aku bebaskan dia dari perbudakan.
And so the master of the house, he responds by saying, because it is you who is asking me, then I will not scold my servant for being late.
Maka bahagia Nabi Muhammad.
And so Prophet Muhammad SAW was overcome with joy, was happy.
Karena itulah kebahagiaan Nabi ketika melihat umatnya selamat.
Because that is the happiness, the joy of Prophet Muhammad SAW when he sees that his ummah is saved.
Tapi Rasul SAW bertanya kepada orang tersebut pertanyaan.
But Prophet Muhammad asked that person a question.
Kenapa aku tadi salam, kok yang baru ketiga kau jawab? Padahal salamku tiga kali, satu, dua, kau enggak jawab. Kenapa baru tiga yang kau jawab?
Prophet Muhammad asked, how come you only answered my salam on the third salam? I asked once, I asked twice, but you only replied on the third time.
Maka tuan rumah tadi adalah orang yang pandai. Dia menjawab, ya Rasulullah, kami menjawab salammu dari awal kau salam.
The master of the house was a clever man. He said, actually, O Messenger of Allah, we have been responding to your salam since the start.
Akan tetapi aku menjawab salammu ketika kau mengatakan assalamualaikum. Kami sepakat menjawabnya dengan pelan-pelan, waalaikumsalam.
We were responding to your salam from the start, but we agreed, the master and his children, we agreed to respond quietly or with a low voice.
Kedua kali kau mengatakan assalamualaikum, kami menjawab waalaikumsalam.
The second time we also responded with a low voice. Waalaikumsalam.
Ketiga kali baru kami menjawab, kenapa ya Rasulullah? Sebab kalau kami jawab pertama kali waalaikumsalam, maka kau akan mendoakan satu keselamatan untuk kami saja. Tapi ketika kami menjawab dengan pelan, tiga kali kau mendoakan selamat untuk kami dan keluarga kami.
The reason why we wanted you to give salam three times is because if we replied immediately with a loud voice, then we would only get one dua for being saved from you. But because you gave salam three times, you made three du'as for us to be saved.
Maka senyum Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam dan mengatakan, kau orang yang cerdas.
So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled and says, yes, you are a clever person.
Itulah bagaimana cintanya Nabi Muhammad kepada umatnya, akhlaknya Nabi Muhammad kepada umatnya.
And so that is the character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How much he cares for his ummah and how much he wants to make sure we are saved from Jahannam.
Kalau kita bicara tentang akhlak Nabi Muhammad, begitu banyak karena langsung Allah yang memujinya.
If we want to go into detail about the character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are so many because Allah Subhanahu wa taala talks about them in detail.
Yang kedua adalah bagaimana paras beliau Nabi Muhammad, yaitu keindahan zatnya Nabi Muhammad.
The second part of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the way Allah Subhanahu wa taala has made him noble is aside from his character but also from his physical form.
Beliau baginda Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah makhluk yang paling indah yang pernah diciptakan oleh Allah Subhanahu wa taala.
He sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the most beautiful creation that Allah Subhanahu wa taala has created.
Dari sahabat Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu taala anhu, ketika beliau ditanya tentang kaifa kana Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ketika ditanya tentang bagaimana beliau baginda Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, maka beliau mengatakan, ma ra'aitu khalqan ajmal min Rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, aku belum pernah melihat ciptaan Allah yang lebih indah dari baginda Muhammad.
When the companion Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu ta'ala anhu was asked, how was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what was he like, Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala an responded, I have not seen a creation more beautiful than Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Nabi Muhammad Ummu Ma'bad seorang sahabiah ketika ditanya tentang Rasulullah, beliau menjawab, ajmalun nas min ba'id wa ahsanuhu wa ahlahu min qarib. Nabi Muhammad orang yang paling indah ketika lihat dari jauh. Semakin dekat semakin indah, semakin dekat semakin manis, itulah beliau baginda Muhammad.
Another companion, Ummu Ma'bad radhiyallahu ta'ala anha, was asked this a similar question, and her response was, he is the most beautiful creation seen from afar, and the closer you get to him, the more beautiful he is.
Itu beda dengan kita. Kalau kita masya Allah dari jauh kelihatan indah, ketika dekat kelihatan kalau kita tidak begitu indah.
That is different from us. Maybe if we were seen from a distance, you can see that we are beautiful to the eye. But the closer people get to us, the more our defects show. Nah,
kadang kita melihat orang di televisi begitu indah, tapi ketika melihat aslinya tidak begitu indah.
For example, sometimes on television, when we see someone, they look so beautiful, so nice. But when we see them in real life, they aren't as wonderful as they were.
Apalagi zaman sekarang 360 HP. Kalau sudah selfie, dia kelihatan masya Allah indahnya, tapi aslinya dia tidak seindah itu.
Especially nowadays when you can do a selfie 24/7 365, when you see someone, they take a selfie and they look so nice, and then you see them in person, nah, it's not that one.
Kalau Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam tidak, dari jauh indah, semakin dekat semakin indah, itulah Nabi Muhammad.
But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seen from afar, the most beautiful, and the closer you get, he becomes even more beautiful.
Sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mempunyai keindahan dari ujung rambut sampai ke ujung kaki.
The beauty, the jamal of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is such that it is from the tip of his hair to the tip of his toe.
Semua yang ada pada Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah keindahan.
All that was on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was beauty.
Bahkan kalau di orang lain itu adalah satu kekurangan, buat Nabi Muhammad adalah satu kelebihan.
Even things that would be normally considered defective, a defect on other people, if you find it on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it looks like a source of beauty.
Seperti arok, keringat. Siapapun orang di muka bumi ini pasti mempunyai keringat yang baunya tidak enak. Tapi Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mempunyai keringat yang baunya begitu indah.
An example of such a defect is sweat. We normally associate sweat with bad odor, but the sweat of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the scent is so wonderful.
Ummu Sulaim, ibu dari Sayyidina Anas bin Malik, beliau berkata ketika suatu saat Nabi Muhammad tertidur di waktu musim panas, keringat itu dari dahinya mengkucur, kemudian diambil dan dicium, baunya begitu wangi hingga dibuat parfum dalam tubuhnya. Ketika ditanya, apa parfummu begitu wangi, maka beliau menjawab, aku memakai tip atau wewangian dari keringat Nabi Muhammad. Sayyidina Anas.
The sweat of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was such that one companion, Ummu Sulaim, the mother of Anas radiallahu anhu, there was a time in summer when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam lay sleeping, and sweat was pouring from his forehead. And Ummu Sulaim took some of that sweat, and she smelled it, and it smelled so beautiful. So she applied it to herself, and people asked, "What kind of tayyib, what kind of perfume do you use, such that you smell so nice?" And she said, "This is from the sweat of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam."
Dan apa beliau berjalan di satu tempat, orang tahu Rasulullah baru saja lewat sini dari apa? Bau keringat Nabi Muhammad yang masih melekat di tempat tersebut.
And people would know if there was a road or a path, and people would know that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had just walked there, because the sweat from that was left in the places he walked would still be there, and they smelled.
Kalau dalam suatu hadis disebut, idza safaha ahadan, kalau Nabi Muhammad bersalaman dengan seseorang, melekat keringatnya itu di tangan, di kaki, di tangan seseorang, 3 hari bau tersebut menempel, bau indah atau wanginya Nabi Muhammad.
It was narrated that when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would shake someone's hand, and his sweat would stick to the other person's hand, only after 3 days would that scent, that beautiful scent, would go away.
Begitu indah Nabi Muhammad. Begitu indah Nabi Muhammad. Keringatnya pun seperti itu. Maka berhak untuk kita mencintai beliau Nabi Muhammad. Apa kita rela anak-anak kita mencintai seseorang yang dia itu jauh daripada keindahannya Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Selera mereka begitu rendah.
Even for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his sweat was that wonderful. How then could we bear to love someone who is so far physically and in character, such a person, they have such low tastes, such low standards?
Itu keringat yang tidak mungkin ada orang di muka bumi ini yang punya keringat wangi kecuali beliau Nabi Muhammad.
That kind of sweat, there is no one else on the face of this earth who would have such a wonderful, whose sweat would have such a wonderful scent other than Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Yang kedua adalah ludah. Ludah Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah ludah yang wangi dan obat. Hingga diriwayatkan dalam suatu hadis, Rasulullah apabila beliau meludah, para sahabat mud berebut untuk mengambil ludah Nabi Muhammad.
Another example of something that is considered a defect or something negative, spit is usually a source of insult, but the spit of the Prophet, the saliva of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it had a wonderful scent as well, and it is also a source of medicine. It is also a cure, such that there was a narration in a hadith when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would spit somewhere, the companions would rush to gather some of it, collect some of it.
Ludah Nabi adalah obat.
The saliva of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a medicine.
Walaupun sebelum beliau menjadi nabi.
Even before he was made a prophet.
Dalam kitab Sirah Halabiyah disebutkan ketika Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam usia 6 tahun ketika matanya sakit, oleh Abdul Muttalib, kakek beliau Nabi Muhammad, dibawa ke satu sauma'ah, yaitu kuil. Di kuil ada satu pendeta di situ yang pandai mengobati orang yang sakit. Kemudian Abdul Muttalib meminta untuk cucunya ini diobatkan. Ketika kemudian anak Rasulullah diberikan oleh pendeta tersebut, si pendeta bertanya, siapa ini? Abdul Muttalib mengatakan, ini anakku, padahal cucunya. Kemudian setelah dilihat, ini enggak mungkin kalau ini adalah anakmu. Pasti ini adalah cucumu. Kenapa? Karena dilihat semua yang ada pada Rasulullah adalah tanda-tanda seorang nabi.
So
Nabi Muhammad.
So when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was still a youth, was still in his early age, he had a sickness in his eye. And so his grandfather Abdul Muttalib took him to a sawma'ah, which is like a temple, and there was a priest of some sort there, who was very good at curing various diseases. And so Abdul Muttalib introduces Prophet Muhammad as his son, and the priest says, no, this cannot be your son. Most likely he is your grandson. Why? Because the priest recognized the features of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Dan Nabi akhir zaman adalah seorang yatim, tidak punya orang tua.
And the Nabi, the final prophet close to the day of judgment, is someone who did not, whose father was not alive.
Abdul Muttalib berkata, wahai pendeta, ini bukan urusanmu, saya enggak tanya ini nabi atau tidak, tapi ini matanya sakit, sembuhkan.
So Abdul Muttalib interjects saying, I didn't ask you about a prophet or whatever, I just want you to cure the disease in his eye.
Kemudian pendeta itu berkata, apakah seorang dokter mendatangi seorang dokter yang lain, bahwa dokter yang bisa menyembuhkannya adalah dia sendiri, karena nabi akhir zaman ini adalah dia adalah seorang yang disebut tabib. Kemudian beliau berkata, kalau kau ingin matanya dia sembuh, ambil dari ludahnya wahai Abdul Muttalib dan letakkan di matanya sendiri, niscaya dia akan sembuh.
So the priest responds with a rhetorical question, do you know any doctor who comes to another doctor when in fact he himself is the most capable doctor of curing a disease? It is said that the prophet, the final prophet, is a tabib. If you want to cure his disease, just take some of his saliva and apply it to the area where the disease is.
Maka Abdul Muttalib mengambil dari ludah Nabi Muhammad dan diletakkan di mata beliau, dan ketika itu pun sembuh.
And so Abdul Muttalib took the saliva of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and applied it to the area of his eye where the disease was, and Immediately, it was immediately cured.
Kemudian di perang Khaybar.
And then in the battle of Khaybar.
Ketika Rasulullah Shallallahu Alaihi Wasallam memerintahkan para sahabat untuk keluar untuk perang Khaybar, Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Thalib ketika itu tidak ikut perang. Kenapa? Matanya sakit. Kemudian Rasul berkata kepada sahabat, panggil Ali bin Abi Thalib dan ikut untuk ikut perang Khaybar. Panggil dia untuk menemuiku.
So when the companions were preparing for war, when they set off for war, Ali bin Abi Thalib, he did not follow because he had there was something wrong with his eye. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Ali ibn Abi Talib, prepare and come, and he told the other companions to call Ali ibn Abi Talib to him.
Kemudian Sayyidina Ali ketika itu sambil memegang matanya datang kepada Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ini musabun birramat ya Rasulullah, aku kena makin sakit mata ya Rasulullah. Kemudian oleh Nabi diambil ludahnya Rasulullah dan diletakkan di matanya, dan ketika itu pun sembuh dan Sayyidina Ali ikut berperang.
And so Ali bin Abi Talib comes to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam holding his eye and explains, O Prophet Muhammad, there's something wrong with my eye. And as before, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam took some of his saliva, applied it to the part of the eye that of Ali bin Abi Talib that was hurting, that it had a problem, and it was cured there and then, and Ali bin Abi Talib immediately joined the battle as well.
Itu penyakit yang lahir. Begitu juga penyakit yang batin. Ludah Nabi Muhammad menyembuhkan seseorang yang punya penyakit yang batin, yaitu penyakit akhlak atau penyakit sesuatu yang tak tampak, yaitu penyakit kekurangan pada seseorang.
And that is the case for physical diseases, but it is also the case for internal spiritual diseases, things that don't always show on our body. And the saliva of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was used to cure the spiritual, the internal disease of someone, yani disease of character.
Seorang wanita yang lisannya suka menyakiti hati orang lain, kata-kata yang keluar darinya adalah kata-kata yang tidak baik.
There was a woman whose tongue would always say things that were unkind to other people.
Suatu saat Rasulullah makan bersama para sahabat, wanita itu datang kepada Nabi.
So at one, there was a time when Prophet Muhammad SAW was having a meal with some of his companions, and she came as well.
Maka mulailah wanita itu berkata-kata yang tidak baik atau ingin menyakiti Rasulullah.
And so that woman started to say things with the intention of hurting Prophet Muhammad SAW.
Berkata wanita tersebut, "Aantan Nabi? Apakah kau seorang Nabi?"
She said, "Are you a prophet? Aantum Nabi?"
Kemudian Rasulullah menjawab, "Ya, betul, aku seorang Nabi."
Prophet Muhammad SAW replied, "Yes, I am a prophet."
"Bagaimana kau seorang Nabi makan tanpa menawarkan kepada aku yang belum makan?"
So she said, "How can a prophet eat when he has not offered me any food?"
Maka Rasulullah SAW menawarkan makanan yang ada di tangannya. "Mari silakan untuk makan, yang ada di piringnya dikasihkan."
So Prophet Muhammad SAW offered her the food that his hand was holding, and he gave it to her on a plate, and he said, "Please eat."
Kemudian perempuan itu berkata, "Jangan nanggung kalau ngasih, sekalian yang di tanganmu lepaskan."
And so she told Prophet Muhammad SAW, don't hold back on the food you're going to give me. That which is already in your hand, put it on the plate and give it to me."
Kemudian dilepas oleh Rasulullah yang di tangannya. Sahabat ketika itu marah karena perempuan ini memang selalu apabila berkata berbuat tidak menyaman bagi orang lain.
And so Prophet Muhammad SAW did so. He let go of the food that was already in his hand, put it on the plate and served it to her. And the companions who were there, they were getting upset because this woman was well known for saying things that were just, they would hurt people.
Kemudian Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam memberikan yang di tangannya, masih saja berkata perempuan itu dan berkata, "Wahai Muhammad, yang sisa di mulutmu keluarkan sekalian."
So this woman, she keeps asking, like, it's don't stop at the things that are already held in your hand. That which is still in your mouth, put it on the plate and offer it to me.
kemudian diberikan Rasulullah, yang di piring, yang di tangan, yang di mulut diberikan.
So Prophet Muhammad SAW gave everything to her, that which was still on the plate, that which was on his hand, and even that which was in his mouth.
Sahabat ketika itu yang melihat kejadian tersebut, meneliti atau menyaksikan, mengikuti perempuan itu makan daripada piring Nabi Muhammad, kemudian yang bekas tangannya Nabi Muhammad, dan diperhatikan bekas yang tadi dimakan oleh Nabi dimakan oleh wanita tersebut yang itu bercampur dengan ludah Nabi Muhammad.
So the Prophet, the companions who were there, they paid close attention. They looked really closely at the food that this person ate, and indeed she took in some of the food that had mixed with the saliva of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Fawallahi, riwayat mengatakan ketika sahabat tadi itu menyaksikan, fawallahi demi Allah, min ba'dima akalat min athari Rasulillah, itu perempuan yang dah selalu berkata-kata yang tidak baik setelah makan dari bekas Nabi Muhammad yang di situ ada rik atau ludah Nabi Muhammad, fala yakhruj min fiha illa khaira, tidak lagi pernah berkata dari mulut orang tersebut perkataan kecuali kebaikan.
So فَوَاللَّهِ, in the narration, وَاللَّهِ, by Allah, after eating the food that had mixed with the saliva of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after that she would not say anything except that it was khair, it was good. No more nasty stuff from her.
Itulah ludah Nabi Muhammad.
And that is the saliva of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Beda dengan ludah kita.
Obviously it is different from our saliva.
Nah, jika ludah kita ludahkan ke orang, dia akan marah-marah, tapi kalau Nabi Muhammad jadi obat.
Yeah. If we offered our saliva, yani we spat at someone, they'd get upset, but if Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam were to offer his saliva, it becomes a medicine.
Darah Rasulullah.
Another example is the blood of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Darah Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, suatu saat ketika seorang sahabat melakukan hijamah untuk Nabi Muhammad. Kemudian setelah hijamah, Rasulullah darahnya diletakkan di satu mangkuk. Kemudian berkata kepada seorang sahabat, "Wahai sahabat, keluarlah ke padang pasir, buang darahku tersebut." Kemudian sahabat mengambil mangkuk tersebut dan ingin sampai pergi ke padang pasir untuk membuangnya. Tapi ketika sampai di padang pasir, ketika mau membuang, dia takut, ini gimana, dibuang atau tidak, sayang darah Nabi Muhammad. Daripada dibuang, akhirnya dia minum darah Rasulullah. Setelah dia pulang, ditanya oleh baginda Muhammad SAW, ditanya, "Sudahkah kau buang?" Dia katakan, "Sudah." "Di mana?" "Di perutku ya Rasulullah." Kemudian apa kata Rasulullah? "Wawallahi demi Allah, darahku yang mengalir di tubuhmu akan menjadi sebab di mana tidak akan disentuh oleh api neraka Allah."
Blood is usually considered an impurity, but the blood of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is something else. In one narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the bloodletting, the hijama, was done on him, and the darker blood was taken and put into a bowl. And so Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the companion who did the hijama, "Go to the desert and throw this blood away." So the companion goes into the desert, but he thinks twice, "Should I really throw it away?" Or so instead he drinks the blood, and he returns to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Prophet Muhammad asks him, "Have you thrown away the blood?" And the companion says, "Yes, I have." And he says, "I threw it away in here," as in he drank it. He pointed to his stomach. And so Prophet Muhammad SAW explains, "Wallahi, that blood of mine which flows in your veins shall not be touched by the flames of Jahannam."
Coba, darah, ludah, keringat, ini semua adalah hal yang menjijikkan setiap manusia, tapi buat Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah keindahan yang tidak dimiliki orang manapun.
So these things, saliva, sweat, blood, are things that if they came from anyone else, they would be things we consider disgusting, but because they come from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are considered a beauty. They are a beauty.
Kemudian keindahan yang seperti ini, anak-anak kita tidak mengenalnya, tidak mengetahuinya, maka malah justru kadang-kadang anak-anak kita dan keluarga kita lebih kenal seseorang yang seumur hidup kadang-kadang belum pernah sekalipun sujud kepada Allah.
So, how is it then that our children our grandchildren, they don't know things like this about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They know more about people who have maybe never done sajda even once in their life.
Maka demi Allah, apabila kita, anak-anak kita, keluarga kita membaca sejarah Nabi Muhammad, semakin kita baca akan semakin kita cinta dan rindu kepada beliau.
So our children, our families, if they were to read, to go through the seerah, the history of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his life, how could they not fall in love with him?
Karena beliau Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah paling indahnya makhluk yang pernah Allah ciptakan.
Because he is the most beautiful creation that Allah Subhanahu wa taala had ever created.
Maka itu mari, ayo tumbuhkan rasa cinta kepada Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yang dengan cinta kita akan pasti ada ittiba, yaitu mengikuti. Dengan mengikuti kita akan dicintai oleh Allah Subhanahu wa taala.
So let us then nurture, cultivate this love for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. By loving him, we would follow him, follow his way, his path. And in doing so, as said in the ayah in the Quran, Allah Subhanahu wa taala will love us.
Saya akan tutup majelis ini dengan satu cerita. Masih ada waktu untuk satu cerita?
Do we have time for one more story before Isha? Three more minutes. 3 menit lagi.
3 menit. Okay. Nas'alullah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yarzukna kamalal mutaba'ah bin Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa nas'alullah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yaj'alna wal hadirina minal mutahabina fillah, mutaakhina mutazawirina fillah. An Allah yaghfir dhunubana wa yastur ayubana wa yufarrij kurubana. Wa nas'alullah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yaj'al hadhal jama' wa an yaj'al hadhal ijtima' إن شاء الله حجة لنا لا علينا وكما أن الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجمعنا في هذه الدنيا فاجمعنا يا الله في يوم القيامة مع النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأنت راض عنا على هذه النية وكلنا صالح جامع لخير الدنيا والآخرة وإلى حضرة النبي الفاتحة